What goes around comes around. this in a negative context. But in biblical language, we see a clear positive side to the saying. Let's look in 2 Corinthians 9:10. How may he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food supply and multiply the seed you have sown and increase the fruits of your righteousness? Let's look at it again. God supplies seed to us, the sower. We sow the seed that he has provided us with, and he multiplies that seed that he's given us. Now, how good is that? He gives us, we give something back, and he gives us more. Then we sow once again with the seed that was multiplied, and the process continues. Now, I'm not sure about this, but about you, but this is very exciting to me, because with what God gives you, when you sow, you start the process of multiplication. So if you sow a 10 rand today, in a year's time you should sow 10,000. But it's not about the finances once again. This is a principle for your life, whether it's in your finances, whether it's in your spiritual life. What you sow now, you will reap in a week's time, or 2 weeks' time, or a month, or a year. This is God's plan for us, it's blessing. It's God's plan for us to be blessed. He says in Jeremiah 29:11, I've got a plan for you to
prosper.
To what?
Prosper.
Okay, so he's got a plan for us to prosper. Whether it's in our finances, whether it's in our spiritual, whether it's in our physical. In all things he wants us to prosper. When we sow seed into God's kingdom, he blesses us with a harvest which he can now sow back into his work. And the process continues once again. This is God's plan for blessing us. It's all over the Bible. So today, when you give, let's remember that we are sowing seed into God's kingdom. And that we will receive a harvest of that. It's biblical. Malachi 3:10, God says, test me on this. So he's telling you, give it to my ministry, test me on it, and I will open up the heavens upon you. So let's take our tithes and offerings, take it in your hand, put it above your head, and say, Lord, today,
Lord, today,
I sow in your word,
I sow in your word,
I know that you are faithful,
to bring me a harvest,
and I thank you for it. I stand on your word in faith, and I receive my blessing. Amen. Even the people that couldn't give, Lord God, as you said in your word, provide. providing the seed, Father God, so that they can start that cycle in their lives, Father God. And I pray and I ask for each and every person sitting here, Father God, will become kingdom finances, Father God. And that means that they will sow finances into your ministry, that they will look after poor people, that they will spread the word, that they will train people, that they will equip people in each and every facet of your kingdom, Father God. We pray it this morning by the blood and by the name of Jesus. Amen. Right, who's happy to be here?
Amen.
Amen.
Can't hear you?
Amen.
Caleb, are you happy to be here this morning?
Why do you think I'm here?
Amen, amen, amen.
We're happy to see you.
Praise the Lord.
The message for this morning is, what is the full armor of God? How can I put it on? Or how can I put on the whole armor of God? Now, I'm going to need your help here. Keanu, quickly bring our little stick there. Ik dacht dat. Ik denk dat hij ook een van die stoelen is op de opje op dat. Ja. Right, now I'm going to share something here with each and every one. Right, here we've got the full armor of God. Okay, everyone agree with me? Can everyone see it? If you can't see it, come get on stage. What is this? Okay, that is the helmet. That's part of the armor of God. Everyone agree with me?
Yeah.
Okay, what is this?
Breastplate.
Okay, what is this?
Shield.
Okay, there is the?
Belt.
Awesome. Okay, there it's a bit dull, you can't see it, but what is there?
The shoes.
And lastly, what's there?
Sword.
Okay. What does this represent?
The armor of God.
Okay. What does this person look like?
Warrior.
I can't hear you say it again.
Warrior.
A warrior. Okay, so Ephesians tells us to put on
full armor.
Okay. Does he say just for Yanni, Pity, or Sunny?
No, everybody.
Okay, so the word speaks to everyone. So that, what does that mean? It means each and every person is a warrior.
Amen.
In the kingdom of God. Amen. Do you agree with me? So it's each and every person's responsibility to be a warrior in prayer. It's not just specifically for Yanni, Pity, or Sunny, but in some people, the unction is a bit stronger than in other people. But this is for each and every person you are. Like last week we said, each and every person here is a pastor. Don't believe me, go read the Bible. Go out and make disciples of men. Now, if you're not a disciple, how can you make a disciple of men? So if you study your word, you're strong in your word, you know what your word says, and you know you're strong in your prayer life, you are a pastor. If you put on your full armor of God, you are a warrior. So you are, each and every person sitting here is a prayer warrior. Now you choose whether you are or not. Because you choose. The Holy Spirit wakes you up at 3 o'clock in the morning. You choose, am I going to get up and go pray? Or am I going to sleep? You walk in pick and pay, and the Holy Spirit tells you, pray for that person. You choose. Do I pray for him or not? The armor of God is a metaphor in the Bible, Ephesians 6 verse 10 to 8, that both reminds Christians about the reality of spiritual battle and describes the protection available to them.
Amen.
So, when you are a spiritual warrior, you're going to use this a lot, and you're going to use your shield a lot.
Yeah.
Amen. Look, the other stuff you're also going to use, but that is going to be your attack block. Attack block. Attack block. Run closer. Attack. That's what we do, family. That's what we need to do. The full armor of God that Christians are called to put on. Listen here, the full armor of God that Christians are called to pull on compromises of the belt of truth, the breastplate of righteousness, the gospel of peace, the shield of faith. There's the shield. We need to have our faith. How have you developed your faith? This is how you develop your faith. The helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit. We as Christians need to learn how to implement the armor. We need to know when to start praying. We need to know when it's time to hold up your shield. But this comes back to the last Sunday's message. The authority that we carry. We do not know the authority we carry. Why? Because we don't know our Bible. It's as easy as that. We need to know when we need backup. Now, nowhere in the Word does it say one soldier goes into battle. No, a whole legion or a whole army goes into battle. So don't ever, ever feel scared to ask your spiritual brother, listen here, can you stand in faith with me? Listen here, I've got this boulder on my path. Can you help me to pray for it? Or we need to go minister for so and so. Can you go help me? Now you're going to say, yeah, but I'll show you it's scriptural. It's scriptural. What happened with Moses when they were battling? They had to hold up his arms. Why? Because he got tired. What happened when he dropped his arms? The battle swayed the other way. What happened when they lifted up his arms? It went to the side of the Jewish nation again. It's biblical. So if you need someone in your prayer life to hold you up or just to back you, ask. Don't be shy. We're all in this together. Your prayer life should be fantastic as a spiritual warrior. You can't spend 2 minutes in prayer life and 5 minutes in your Bible and now you reckon, hey, I'm going to take on the devil and his armies. You're going to be steamrolled like you do not understand. We should know the Word of God. Why? So that you know what authority you carry. So that you, as Jesus did with Satan when he was tempted, he quoted the Word and he said to Satan, the Word says. Now how can you stand up against the enemy if you don't know your Word? We need to realize the authority we've got in Christ and we need to start using it. Arm of God in Scripture. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in His mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the power of the dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything to stand, stand firm then. So you know your authority, you're starting your warfare now, and you say to Satan, I am standing firm. Doof. You can do whatever you want. This is what the Word says. Come try your luck. That's what we need to do. With a belt of truth buckled around your waist, with a breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with a readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. Amen. Is everyone still with me? Who's taking notes? Amen. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. And pray in the Spirit on all occasions. Listen to this. The Word doesn't say pray in the Spirit 5 o'clock in the morning for 5 minutes. Each and every, if you want to be a spiritual warrior, each and every free moment you've got, you are going to seek God's face. You are going to seek God's righteousness. It's going to come to a point where you're going to say, you know what, I've got 5 minutes. I'd rather spend it in the Word than to watch Seven the Lawn on TV. Or whatever your show might be. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. Listen to this. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. Daily suiting up in the armor of God can feel abstract, but with prayer and practice, Christian can better understand and implement habits of putting on the full armor of God. Right, now we're going to go to the belt of truth, explained and applied. Stand firm then with a belt of truth buckled around your waist. That's Ephesians 6:14. What this means. Some translations use a phrase like having girded your loins with truth. Loins is an uncommon word in modern vernacular. It refers to the lower back but includes the crotch. So it's this area and this area. Now, what you must remember, the Jews in the old day, so when they had to do something in a hurry, they had to gird it. What does it mean? You pull it up, you pull it to the front, and you fasten it. So it's easier for you to run and to move. In ancient days, men would wear long robes that would get in the way of work or fighting. So they would wrap up the long draping material. This was girding up one's loins. The Lord knew our loins needed to be wrapped in truth, regardless of the culture or time we live in. The Lord has seen all the paths we have taken and how they have hurt and derailed us. He knows we need the truth. Our identity is more than our sexuality, but this is one facet of our lives that we often view as a definer. The first area of life in which the enemy frequently attempts to rattle is our sense of identity. And the things pertaining to sex are easy pickings for him. We need freedom regarding sexuality. We need truth about who we are. And only Jesus is the truth that sets us free. Now the first piece of the armor is the belt of truth. Truth by its very definition is exclusive. It means something is true and other things are lies. The evil one is the father of lies, John 8:44. Every lie finds its origin in sin. Every other piece of the full armor of God is attached to the belt of truth. If you don't begin with truth, you'll never defeat the enemy. And Jesus said, the word is true. So if you are not, well, if your feet are not planted in the truth, it doesn't even help you try one of these. John 17, and that was in John 17, 7, the word is true. How to apply it? Pursue the truth on a specific topic, but don't forget to grab hold of the whole of the scripture. So don't just read the part that makes you feel good. Read the whole scripture or the whole passage. Don't just study the parts that come easy for devotional readings. Press into the whole counsel of God's word. Start learning the word so that you know where you stand with the enemy, so that you know the authority you carry. Pray God's word over your life. Use the word of truth as a template to guide your prayer. If you don't know what to pray for, pray scriptures, because this is the truth.
Amen.
Quote the word and stand on the word. That's why we say it's so important. Have your bullet points when you pray, to show the enemy, this is what the word says, and this is what my faith is built on, and this is what I'm standing on, because that is God's word. That is what God says. Memorize the truth for quick access. Memorize the word. Start working through the Bible. Memorize it. So that off a glance you can say to the enemy, John 10:10, you come to kill, steal, and destroy, but God comes to give life and life in abundance. Jeremiah 29:11, this is the plan that God's got for me. Not John 10:10. Mark 11:24, the Lord says, whatever I pray for and I believe, I will receive. Start learning your scriptures. Cover your word with scriptures on post-it notes, screensavers, decor, and anything that will help you to remember. So if you need to pluck little stickers on your wall post-it, do it. Because every time you're going to walk past, you're going to read the scripture, you're going to read the scripture, you're going to read the scripture. After 10 months, you're going to know the scripture and not just read the scripture. Breastplate of righteousness, explained and applied. With a breastplate of righteousness in place, that is Ephesians 6:14, what it means. Righteousness means being made right. Sometimes scriptures refers to righteousness that Christ gives us, his righteousness in 2 Corinthians 5:21. And sometimes scriptures refer to righteousness that God carries out through us, like the righteous acts of the saints, which is in Revelations 9:8. In daily spiritual battle, both varieties of righteousness protects the heart. We need the complete righteousness of Christ, but also the continuing righteousness that comes as a response to God's gift. The enemy tempts with all kinds of sinful entanglements, but righteousness protects your heart. God's instructions are often viewed as killjoys or burdens, but obedience of God's protection for your heart from being wounded by sin. How to apply it? Soak in and obey instructions from the Lord. So you've got a choice. Do I want to do it? Or don't I want to do it? It's easy and as simple as that. If you want to do it, here it says, read your scripture. Soak in it. Let it become rhema word in your life. Allow your spirit man to be changed by the Holy Spirit. If there's an area of your life that feels like it gets easily tangled up in sin, ask your pastor, ask your church leaders, or ask your deacons, or your cell leaders, or your brother in Christ, or your sister in Christ. Ask them to pray with you so you can overcome that stumbling block in your life. And ask them to share scriptures with you so that you can stand on the scriptures, so that your faith can start growing in the scripture. Ask a trusted person to pray for you if you are struggling with obedience. All Christians, each and every person struggles. But none were meant to struggle alone. We make easy targets for the enemy when we do not obey God. Gospel of peace explained and applied. And with the feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. That's in Ephesians 6:15. What it means. Peace is an attribute of the Lord's very person and character. Galatians 5:22. In Greek, peace means oneness or wholeness. Greek dictionary there. The gospel, which means good news, is the forgiveness of sin and access and oneness with God's truth in faith with Christ. This oneness with the Lord produces peace. Ephesians repeatedly reminds us to stand and to stand firm. And if you can't stand firm on your own, get back up. Get all the other people that is involved in your army. Get them to have your back. One of the easiest ways for the enemy to succeed in shaking us loose from standing firm is to tempt us with worry. When we carry anxiousness and worry with us, we are robbed of peace. But the gospel of peace keeps your feet anchored and standing firm. Amen.
Amen.
Are you all with me?
Yeah.
How to apply it? Ask the Lord daily to remind you of His gospel and the words on you and through you. Set your security and identity in His words and not in yours. Don't try to do it out of your own. We read earlier, this fight is not against flesh and bone, but it's against the principalities of darkness. Surround yourself with scriptures about the truth. And remove the input that steals your sense of security in Christ. Censor what we read. Censor what we watch. Censor what we listen to. Censor what we hear other people speak over us. So if the person speaks negativity over you, rebuke it. Stay away. Shield of faith explained and applied. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith. Ephesians 6:16. What it means. When Paul wrote this passage, Roman soldiers carried shields that were covered with heavy animal hide. But listen to this. Listen to this. Animal hide, okay? Leather. Before battle, they would dip their shields into water. I hope you're getting the revelation on that. Animal hide, in the Old Testament, they had animal hide, or in the olden days. Some of the enemy had fiery arrows. So now you've got animal hide, you hold up your shield, that fiery arrow comes, doof, doof. You toast it. But they dipped it in water, so when that fiery arrow hit that shield, with the weakness of the shield, it quenched the fire. So that when the fiery dart hit them, the wet hide would extinguish the dart. In a similar way, a Christian shield of faith needs to be regularly dipped in the water of God's word to be replenished and fully functional. Does it help you? You gave your life 10 years back, you gave your life to God, and oh, I'm a Christian. You haven't read the Bible since, and no, don't worry, I've got the armor of God, I've got the shield. You're going to be steamrolled like you do not believe. Satan likes taking people like that out.
Yeah.
Believe me. Because faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. That is in Romans 10, 17. We need to be focused. We need to know the word. We need to refresh our minds on a daily basis with the word. How to apply it. If your faith feels less confident, then you wish that ask the Lord to increase your faith. Mark 9:24 for your reference. And push in your prayer life and in your Bible study life. Push. 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 God says, seek me. Not he's going to seek you. You need to seek him. You need to equip yourself for the warfare. Find verses that feed your faith. And fill your word, your world, with them. Also connect with Christian pastors, friends and family that will have your back, that will support you, that will join you in your fight.
Come on.
Amen. Set your faith on God's character, not on your circumstances. Whatever you're going through, that is the battle. Look and focus on God. Helmet of salvation, explain and apply. Take the helmet of salvation, Ephesians 6:17. Salvation comes from the moment we place our trust on Jesus' death and resurrection as the payment of our sin. But salvation is also worked out through the lengthy process of sanctification. The helmet of salvation, like the breastplate of righteousness, rests on the word of Christ to save us. But also involves us as we journey with the Lord and allow Him to work that salvation into every part of our thoughts. The battlefield of the mind is the primary place spiritual battle is fought. The Lord works His freeing truth in your perspective while the enemy fights for strongholds to bind you. John 10:10 for your reference. Now, how to apply it? Surrender thoughts that don't line up with Scripture. As Colossians 3:2 says, set your mind on things above, not on earthly things. Renew your mind daily with prayer and with the Word of God. Seek the word and the truth. Matthew 6:33. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Remember the Lord's character and faithfulness in Scripture as well as in your life experience. Wash your mind with the renewing of the Word. As Romans 12:2 says, do not conform to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, and you will be able to test and approve what God's will is. His good, pleasing, and perfect will. Sword of the Spirit. And the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, Ephesians 6:17. The explanation of the piece of the armor is right there in the verse. It is the Word of God. And it's the only piece of armor that is both defensive and offensive. So you can use it to protect yourself, or you can use it to fight. When we are tempted, the most effective weapon that God has given us as believers is the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Jesus modeled this so beautifully during his temptation in the wilderness. When the devil tried temptation after tempting against him, Jesus used the Word as the Spirit. See Luke 4, verse 1 to 13. When the devil tempted him three times, Jesus responded with the truth of the Word every time. Don't be afraid to ask for help in your warfare in Christ. Exodus 17:12, when Moses' hands grew tired, they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat on it. Aaron and Hur held up his hands, one on one side, one on the other, so that his hands remained steady till sunset. So it's important. Come Wednesday evenings to intercession prayers. If you want breakthrough in your life, you need to be here to take part. Yes, the group here can pray for you. Yes, the Word says it. But when are we going to grow up to say, I am standing in for my wife, my family, my finances, my health, my spiritual growth? When are the priests of the house taking up that responsibility and telling the wife and kids, we are going to pray? Or we are having Bible study in the evenings. We are going to pray, not for ourselves, but for our neighbor. Because when you see God, His righteousness, and you pray for your neighbor, 10 to 1 your neighbor is praying for you. Why is it always about ourselves, praying for ourselves? Why is the spiritual warfare not for your brother or your sister, but always for yourself? Amen. Matthew 8:18-24, where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am with them. Close your eyes for a second there. See this in your mind. We all know we're more than two people. See in your mind's eye who is sitting next to you, or behind you, or in front of you, because he says, for where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am with them. He doesn't say, I'll send my angels, or I'll send the Holy Spirit. No. God says, for where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there. So don't take the spiritual warfare on your own. where you and your wife are standing in unity and doing spiritual warfare. What does God say? I am there with you. When you and your friend are praying for your neighbor, God says, I am there with you. Family, this is a very, very, very big responsibility, not just for Yanni or Sally. This is for each and every person sitting here. As the Great Commission was given to each and every person in the Word, spiritual warfare was given to each and every person. That is why it's so important in Ephesians, where the Word says, put on your armor. Why? To sit on the couch? No, because God knows you are going to go into warfare. Christianity, I've said it once or twice, Christianity is not for the faint of hearted. Christianity is for the people willing to fight. Christianity is for the person willing to pray for his wife, for his children, for his neighbor. Christianity is where the self, the I, dies. And it's more about God and less about us. So family, put on your warfare, put on your armor, get ready for warfare. We're getting into a time where we're going to need to do this more and more and more regularly, where we're going to need to do it as a collective group. The Word is also very clear on do not forsake the gatherings of the saints. Why? So we can come together as a family, that we can do warfare as a family. When you won 10,004 on your side, when you two, how many four on your side? When you five, how many? When you 10 people, how many? That multiplication effect. That's why unity in the marriage is so important. It's easier for the enemy to attack man and wife that is united in Christ than it is for one person standing on his own. It's more difficult for you. So identify a brother or a sister in Christ and get connected to them. Identify your pastor or your leader or your shell shepherd or whoever. Get connected. And let's do this fight together. Amen.
Amen.
Let's quickly close in prayer. Father God, we just thank you for the opportunity we had here, Lord God, to share in your Word, Lord God. To see how we can apply the Word in our lives, Father God, to see how each and every person is identified as a spiritual warfare. Lord God, but we pray and we ask the Holy Spirit to help us, to guide us, to equip us, so that we can fully comprehend what this is about, that we can fully apply each and every facet to our lives, Lord God, that we can become supernatural warriors in your kingdom, Lord God. That every time we pray a prayer, it will make a difference, Father God. Every time we put our foot down regarding an issue, it will make a difference. Every time we raise our shield, we will be protected. Father God, we pray that this morning, by the blood and by the name of Jesus Christ, Father God, I just also pray for each and every person as we go home this morning, Father God, to protect them, be with them, lead them, guide them, and then that this Word will become a rainbow Word in their lives. Amen. Number 6, verse 24, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord makes his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.
Amen.
Family, you're more than welcome to join us here at Dave Groshall Ministries. If you're watching online, come join us. 9 o'clock on a Sunday morning. Wednesday evenings, we've got corporate prayer here. If you want breakthroughs in your life, if you want healing in your life, start coming on a Wednesday. Start learning how to stand on your own faith. Start learning how to take back the authority. Start learning how to take back everything the enemy has stolen from you. And allow the Lord to give you peace. Amen.